Hi there, this is Radio Amateur Papa Alpha 8 Whiskey. The name is Will, and in this video I would like to show you the new Radio Direction Finder RDF42. RDF, as you may know, is short for Radio Direction Finder. The RDF42 is a single channel, 4 antenna RDF, just like the simpler RDF41. It can operate as a phase RDF, often called pseudo-Doppler, using four antennas arranged in a quarter-wave square. Additionally, it can operate as an amplitude RDF, using an array of four directional antennas, or using a five-element switchable directional antenna like the one you find on my website. The amplitude method does have some advantages over the phase method. For this video, I've set up a system using a VHF phase array and the IC746 Pro receiver. The audio from the receiver is plugged into the RDF42, and the RDF is connected to a laptop using a standard USB cable. The laptop runs RDFMapper, a mapping program written for this purpose by Jonathan Muster from New Zealand. The RDF42 exports its bearings to the laptop, and the RDFMapper plots them on the map. At the same time, RDFMapper can upload these bearings to a server and download bearings produced by other RDF stations and plot them on the map simultaneously. So with this setup, I can hunt a radio signal with my mobile RDF and compare my mobile bearings with the bearings produced by my home RDF, conveniently presented real-time on a single map. Now let's focus on the RDF42 itself. It has some features the RDF41 doesn't have. The main difference is that in the RDF41 I try to minimize the number of settings necessary to make it do a proper job, where in the RDF42 I made all important or interesting settings user changeable and storable. This means that the RDF42 could potentially outperform the 41, but at the same time the RDF42 user would have plenty of opportunity to make the wrong choices and end up with poor performance. Please note that the variations in bearing you see are pretty much larger than normally, due to the fact that I lowered my antenna since there are very high wind conditions right now over here. So normally you would see a more stable reading. Okay, let's look at the display first. In the top line there's the model number PAAW RDF42. Below that, the battery voltage, followed by the preset number P1, which is default. And DF stands for digital filter, which is now automatically following adaptive averaging. More on that later. C282 stands for calibration, set at 282 degrees. The necessary calibration number depends on your receiver and antenna setup, and it's set to make the system point into the right direction. Therefore, it has a range of 360 degrees, of course. The A stands for averaging. In this case, I use adaptive averaging, which automatically sets the best averaging depending on the current and the past measurements. When measurements fluctuate to the left and right a bit, often due to modulation or reflections, the averaging is increased to stabilize the reading. But when new measurements all appear to the left or all to the right, then the RDF42 knows something is changing, maybe a change in row direction, and it reduces averaging to follow that change more rapidly. Max averaging is 255, and this value is user changeable. There is, however, a second operation mode, burst mode, for catching very short signals, in which no averaging is done, simply because a burst is too short to do that. The third number on that line is Q, which stands for quality of measurement. So every measurement is judged and gets a quality number from 0 to 9 depending on signal size and symmetry. Theoretically, a good clean measurement should show a nice symmetry right here. That's a symmetry indicator. So the horizontal lines in the indicator should be equally long left and right of the center marker. Any non-symmetry indicates that the antennas are in a multipath electromagnetic field, which decreases the credibility and accuracy of the measurement. In this case, there's some multipath involved. That's why the Q value isn't a solid Q9 all the time. The fat number over here is the long time average. The long time average bearing is the same as the long line in the Pylorus. And in the Pylorus, there are more lines. Right now, you can't see them clearly, but when I reduce the amount of digital filtering, you see the shorter lines popping up. These are raw bearings without any averaging at all, and altogether they go into a calculation which calculates the long time average. These fluctuations are due to the heavy digital modulation of this transmitter. Right now you can hear it. And also the symmetry indicator indicates that something is going on. So when driving around with a RDF, these smaller lines, the raw bearings, show that you're in a very reflective area, or maybe in a very clean RF area. So they really give you a lot of additional information. Let's put the filter back to where it belongs. Automatic, so it's coupled to the adaptive averaging. So now and then you see the word EX popping up in the right bottom corner. That's when a bearing is being exported. So when a measurement is considered good enough, it's being offered to the serial output, the USB output, for further processing in a computer, for example on RDFMapper. In case you have very poor reception, it might occur that no measurement is considered good enough to be exported. So if you still have a usable bearing, a usable reading, you can force an export manually simply by rotating the encoder. And the last indicator is the elevation indicator. That's an indicator meant for airborne targets like airplanes and radiosondes. It's only a rather crude indicator based on the principle that for an overhead signal, the phase jumps between the antennas of the phase array are smaller compared to a normal situation where the signal is originating from the horizon. In theory, a source straight above the array will not produce phase jumps at all. And note that this indicator needs a constant high quality signal to be reliable. Okay, let's go to the controls. It only has two. The first one is the audio volume, because it has a audio amplifier built in and a built-in speaker. So you can use any line out signal from a receiver to feed into the RDF. The second one is the most important control, which is a rotary encoder with switch. With that, you can go to the menu, step to all the menu positions, and select one and select the value you want and enter this value by pushing the knob. And then it returns to the normal operation mode again. The backside of the RDF42 has an extra bus, a connector, that accepts a second rotary encoder that can be plugged in parallel to the one on the RDF, so that can be used for maybe the mid console of your car, so you have a encoder just within reach of your hand. Okay, so now we're gonna walk through all menu steps. Let's start at backlight. Right now it's on 3 because that's a useful value for this video. And you selected the number, the right number, just by rotating, and you enter this number by pushing the knob. And the next one is the digital filter. You see the last position is auto, then the digital filter is coupled to the adaptive averaging, but you can set a fixed number. 7 is the highest number and 0 is the lowest number. Put it back to auto. The next one is export queue, which sets the export threshold for a measurement to be exported. So you can put it very critical or set the threshold very low. In this case, you will get a lot of rubbish on the map, so a good position is at least 5 or 6 or so. Next one, export window, does about the same thing. Only it sets the maximum deviation that a measurement may have compared to the long time average to be exported. So right now it's a very critical setting. Only the very best measurements are being exported to keep the rubbish off the map. Next one, the queue squelch. This sets the minimum queue necessary for acceptance of a measurement. Measurements with a lower queue are being ignored. Maximum 8, minimum 0. Next one is the averaging mode. Right now, the maximum is set at 255, 255. And you can set it very low. And the lowest position is the burst mode. The next position is azimuth calibration. Right now at 282 degrees, this value is necessary to make the RDF point into the right direction, depending on a lot of factors like your receiver, the internal delay of the receiver, and the type of antenna, the way you put up your antenna. So with azimuth calibration, you can make every correct setup point into the right direction. Right now, 282 is necessary for this situation. Next one, elevation calibration, does the same thing for the elevation indicator. The elevation depends on the internal sensitivity trimmer as well. So first you would have to set the trimmer for a proper input sensitivity depending on the output of your receiver. And then you can use this elevation calibration to have the elevation indicator point at about 0 degrees or maybe 1 or 2 degrees for a signal that originates from the horizon. Rotation frequency. right now 500 Hertz, which is no coincidence. That's a very good frequency in most communication receivers because it's right in the middle of the audio spectrum in hopefully a very flat part of the passband. So it's a very good compromise. You can go down to 100 Hertz or go up to 1 kilohertz, and after you change the rotation frequency, you will have to recalibrate because a lot of things shift if you pick another frequency. The antenna test. You can turn to the next antenna in the array simply by rotating the encoder. It is not synchronized, so you cannot see which one of four antennas is active, but you can see if there is one antenna underperforming compared to the rest. So that might indicate a defect or something like that. The next one is save and load as preset. If I change a parameter, the RDF42 will work with that new setting as long as I leave the input voltage on the RDF. As soon as I turn it off, it forgets these new settings. So if you want to store them, you will have to do that by save as preset, and you can pick the memory position, runs up to 32 positions, and then you activate by pushing the knob. Right now your changes are saved in position 1. Same counts for load preset, works the same way. You just set the memory position you want and you activate it by pushing the encoder. Well, this concludes the overview of the RDF42's features. And for in-depth information on the RDF41 and 42 and on construction of the necessary antenna arrays, simply Google my call sign, PAAW. And if you find this video useful, please give me a thumbs up so I know it was worth the effort making it. Take care.